Penguin Random House Audio presents The 272, The Families Who Were Enslaved and Sold to Build the American Catholic Church, by Rachel L. Swarns, read for you by Karen Murray. Prologue. Jeremy Alexander was sitting in his office when his cell phone rang. It was 2016, the Wednesday before Thanksgiving. He was looking forward to heading home for the long weekend with his family, but he had been eagerly awaiting this call. The woman on the line was someone who had connected with him on Ancestry, the genealogy website. Jeremy had submitted a DNA sample to Ancestry a few years earlier, hoping to find out more about his family's origins. He'd been born and raised in Chicago, but like most African Americans, his family had roots in the South. The caller's name was Melissa Kemp, and she was from Maryland. She had emailed him a few weeks earlier because she believed that they had a common ancestor, an enslaved woman who had been born in Maryland and sold to Louisiana. He was astonished. Could that be true? "No way," he told her. "My family is all down south. There was never any discussion about a Maryland connection whatsoever." They walked through what they knew about their forebears, untangling the branches of their family tree. Melissa thought the link might be a woman named Anna Mahoney Jones. Her own direct ancestor was an enslaved woman named Louisa Mahoney Mason. Louisa and Anna were sisters torn apart by a slave sale in 1838. Melissa asked if he had heard about the story in the New York Times earlier that year that had described the sale. 272 men, women, and children had been sold by the nation's most prominent Jesuit priests to save Georgetown University, the nation's first Catholic institution of higher learning. Some of those people, she told him, were probably his ancestors. Jeremy was dumbfounded. Did he know about Georgetown? "Are you sitting down?" he asked her. At that very moment, he told her, he was at his desk in an office at Georgetown University, where he was an executive assistant in the college's Office of Technology Commercialization. And Melissa was telling him that the Catholic priests who had founded the university, his employer, had owned and sold his ancestors. "I was completely in shock," he said, "blown away." The story of the sale that shattered the Mahoney family became national news in April 2016, when an article that I wrote, 272 Slaves Were Sold to Save Georgetown, What Does It Owe Their Descendants?, appeared on the front page of the New York Times. I had stumbled onto the story a few months earlier when a colleague at the Times forwarded me an email from Richard J. Cellini, the chief executive officer of a technology company and an alumnus of Georgetown. Richard had become interested in the sale when students at Georgetown had organized a demonstration and a sit-in during the fall of 2015. The students were troubled that the names of the sale's main architects had been memorialized on two campus buildings. Georgetown's administration, which had several months earlier established a working group to find ways to acknowledge and make amends for its roots in slavery, had already been considering a name change and agreed to remove the names. Jesuit scholars and historians of slavery were familiar with Catholic slaveholding, but public memory of that history had largely faded in the United States. As Richard followed the news of the protests from his home in Cambridge, Massachusetts, he began to wonder why so little was known about the hashtag GU272, the group of enslaved people memorialized in a hashtag coined by the protesting students. Richard was a well-to-do white lawyer and a practicing Catholic who had never spent much time considering slavery or racial injustice. But he found himself unable to stop thinking about the enslaved people who had been sold to save his alma mater, people whose names had languished in Georgetown's archives for decades. When he reached out to Professor John Glavin, a member of Georgetown's working group, to get more information about the people who had been sold, he was told that almost all of them had perished in Louisiana, leaving no descendants. Nearly 300 had been sent south, and nearly every one of them had died? University officials say that no one in the university's leadership or in the working group's leadership believed that version of events. Richard didn't believe it either. It seemed completely implausible. Within 2 weeks, he had set up an independent nonprofit, the Georgetown Memory Project, hired 8 genealogists, and raised more than $10,000 from fellow alumni to finance their research. By the time my story ran, his team, led by the genealogist Judy Riffle, not only had determined that more than 200 people had survived the voyage from Maryland to Louisiana, but had identified a handful of living descendants. This is not a disembodied group of people who are nameless and faceless, Richard said. These are real people with real names and real descendants. My article was accompanied by a short companion piece, which invited readers to contact us if they believed they had a personal connection to the sale. More than 1 million people read the stories, including Melissa Kemp, Louisa Mahoney's great-great-great-great-granddaughter, and scores of those readers who had lived for decades with holes in their family histories reached out to us, saying that the articles had finally given them some vital information. But it also left them with agonizing, unanswered questions about their ancestors and the church they loved. Today, the Catholic Church is the largest religious denomination in the United States, with more than 60 million members, more than 19,000 parishes, and enormous influence in the nation's political, cultural, educational, and religious life. Americans often view it as a northern institution that has welcomed, educated, and nurtured waves of newcomers from Europe and Latin America. But there is a darker history, both for the church and for our country. For more than a century, the American Catholic Church relied on the buying, selling, and enslavement of Black people to lay its foundations, support its clergy, and drive its expansion. Without the enslaved, the Catholic Church in the United States, as we know it today, would not exist. The priests in Maryland, who relied on the proceeds derived from slave labor and slavery, built the nation's first Catholic college, the first archdiocese, and the first Catholic cathedral, and helped establish 2 of the earliest Catholic monasteries. Even the clergymen who established the first Catholic seminary operated a plantation and relied on enslaved laborers. The priests prayed for the salvation of the souls of the people they held captive, even as they sold their bodies. The 1838 slave sale that tore the Mahoney sisters apart helped save Georgetown from bankruptcy and helped stabilize the Jesuits in Maryland, aiding them as they established and supported new schools and colleges in the North that would educate generations of immigrants and their children and grandchildren. Yet enslaved Black men, women, and children remain invisible in the origin story traditionally told about the emergence of Catholicism in the United States. Their stories are rarely recounted at Mass, in Sunday school, or in Catholic primary schools and colleges. Their joys and struggles, their determination to resist slavery, and their resilience in the face of it had long been mostly disregarded, if not forgotten, by the very institutions they were forced to serve. I have spent the better part of a decade poring over 18th and 19th century letters, tattered receipts, fraying ledger books, wills, and property records scattered in archives, courthouses, and historical societies, trying to unearth and piece together their stories. Along the way, I learned about Jeremy's and Melissa's ancestors, Anna and Louisa, the Mahoney sisters, who traced their lineage back to the 1600s, when the Jesuits and the family's matriarch, a free Black woman named Anne Joyce, first arrived in Maryland. This book follows the family's trail from one generation to the next, starting with Anne Joyce's arrival in the New World and moving on to her descendants, some of whom found their way to freedom, while the rest lived with the agonizing knowledge that they might never enjoy liberty. Often, though, the trail grows cold. The sisters' footsteps have faded over the course of centuries. Like other slaveholders, the Jesuits typically deprive the enslaved of the tools they need to write their stories.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.